of giants from another planet.
Tom Price isn't interested in giants. His miniature heads are meant to be studied, not worshipped. I wanted to see how he was getting on.
Good seeing you.
How you doing?
Yeah, not too bad.
Oh, it's looking fantastic.
Absolutely, it's almost finished.
Well, you said it was going to be expressionistic.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's coming along nicely.
Sure, slowly.
So, that's a question I was going to ask the other day. Yeah. Is exactly how you begin. I don't know if you started with something really.
Yeah, it's a build up process, I guess.
Uh-huh. But you can't be thinking of me at this stage.
So no, this is.
That's just a generic.
Yeah, it's kind of like staring at a cloud at the moment. You know, kind of you can see things in there. Well, that's how the stage I'm trying to get to. But I was thinking about our conversation about how you work, observing people, kind of maybe in a cafe or something like that. I think this person is going to be engaged in the act of observing something.
This figure will be observing something.
So, which changes the whole inner world of that person, of the character.
Yeah. And it's different to your other work, which is much more,
Normally, it's like absorbed. Yeah, exactly. So, the end result has to be someone observing something and internalising it, as I do, as I think, you do. And so, that's where hopefully this little ball of clay will get to in a few weeks.
Well, it'd be great to see it when it's at that stage where you're actually just, getting it to the refinement I see on the other pieces.
Yeah, I'll be excited. So, yeah.
Okay, well, I'll come back.
Excellent, look forward to it.
Good work, carry on.
Cheers, thank you. Will do.
Although I've no idea how this is going to turn out, I felt like he was genuinely trying to meet me halfway. But how much would this be about me? Mark Quinn's heads aren't just about him. They're made of him. Created with 10 pints of his own frozen blood.
My first impression was that it was actually quite unsettling, just in the way it kind of glows. And it's kind of quite deformed because it's in that tank. You can't really quite make out the shape of it.
My first reaction was that actually it kind of dominated the room. It was striking instantly, but also kind of disturbing, I guess, when I initially looked at it.
It's pushing it, self-portrait, to a kind of absurdist logical conclusion to make the sculpture out of the subject. I'm fascinated by what it is to be a person inhabiting a body, about that bit where something material becomes alive. In a sense, the head is the kind of focus of that transition between the material and the immaterial. I wanted to make a self-portrait that was materially a self-portrait, so made from my body, and also that could only exist in certain conditions. It's like a sculpture on life support. If you pull the plug out, it disappeared. And so it's even more of a sense of something alive. But of course, the paradox being, the more you make something like something, the more it actually shows the difference between the object and the living thing. So it's kind of a sculpture about life and death, I suppose.
It's definitely an interesting piece. It's not anything I've never seen anything like it before.
There are many of these portraits that really catch me. This one not.
I should be horrified, but I'm really rather moved by it. Really, that's all I can say. Compared with all the portraits around, I think it's quite moving. Well, it's making me quite tearful.
Self is not one sculpture. Every 5 years, I make a new self. It was always conceived as a series, and I think that's what's interesting to me about it also, is that these things that are out of time, that are frozen, essentially become testaments to time.
Paying homage to another historical era, I'm going to see Raphael to find out how he's getting on, turning my head into the ideal of a Roman ruler.
Hello.
Hello, sir.
David.
How are you?
Don't call me sir, Raphael.
Hello, Raphael.
Call you, sir.
Yeah, okay, that'll be.
After you've seen this, I should call you something else, too.
Okay,
because whilst, the last time you were here,
yes,
we made a clay sketch, if you remember.
Yes, of course.
And the brief was to make you look like a head of state, a Caesar, a royal,
yeah,
to place onto a coin. And here it is,
okay.
I'll just, and I want your first reaction to it.
Oh, that's fantastic. That's a huge, huge difference.
Does it look like you?
Yeah, yeah.
You sure?
Yeah, absolutely. If anything, yeah, it's slightly better looking.
Slightly better looking.
Slightly better looking, therefore very good looking.
You think you're pretty good looking anyway, but
yeah,
I think it's caught the...
No, I really like that, honestly. I think that's great. I actually look more chiselled than I am, which I literally am, I suppose.
Yes, you're sculpted.
I think it's excellent. I'm surprised how much it's come on from what we did the other day when we were doing the...
That was just a rough sketch,
yeah, I see
to
now.
Get
yeah.
to that stage, because yeah. A lot of it is done on a reverse. If I can show you how that's done, you can actually work on that, on the nose, if you want to make it deeper.
Yes.
You see what I mean?
Yeah.
To bring it forward.
Yes.
So it's all done working in reverse, that, especially all this intricate stuff, which we use these special tools on. And you inscribe that, you go into that to
yes.
dig it in.
It's very, very good. It's the more I look at it, the more I see myself in a different way than seeing a photograph.
It is serious, isn't it? I mean, that's
yeah.
the main thing.
Yeah.
See, a lot of
as
these coins have to be look serious, have gravitas. Otherwise,
yeah.
you know, it's Mickey Mouse money. It's serious to be a leader of men.
It is.
The idealized head of Napoleon Bonaparte had the currency of any emperor. But his death mask captured something else, a real mortal. It was cast just a day and a half after the French ruler died.
We stand in awe of the death mask because we think of it as being in contact with the corpse of a great person, or somebody who's been loved. A death mask is not an inert object, which is just an ordinary artifact. There's an aspect of it, which is that it tries to capture something of the person who's died. And that's something, for our purposes, we might call it the soul or the spirit of that individual.
The art of the death mask is now continued by only a handful of practitioners. Nick Reynolds has been at work on a death mask of the recently deceased artist and bon viveur, Sebastian Horsley.
Sebastian kind of looked like something out of a Dickens book. I mean, you can imagine him sort of like wandering around the sort of Victorian streets of Soho. And had he been alive then, without doubt, he would have been done. I think it's rather fitting a dandy like himself should have himself immortalized in this timeless fashion. I think he would have almost thought it was worth dying for. This is straight out of the negative which came off his face. So basically all I've done is pull off the mold. These bits here, this is the alginate, which as you can still see is still stuck in his nostrils and in his ear. This is as rough as it gets when it comes out. And really all I've got to do with this is pull out some of these stray hairs that I've got trapped in the mold, clean up the neck area. Some people might want the eyes open, you know, and if that's the case, I can sculpt the eyes open and we can put glass ones in. If they actually wanted, I could make the head in silicone and re-punch hair in it and you wouldn't be able to tell it from the real person. I believe death masks are a very, very potent cathartic tool.
I met Sebastian 20 years ago and we were lovers for 10 years and lived together. I received the death mask, Nick delivered it to me, slightly ridiculously in an old Nike box. I was very unsure about what I would think of it. Sebastian